Hello and thank you. Your comments and questions inspired me to make a few more parts of the video about angels, and in them I'm gonna discuss the following topics. How can humanity practically defend itself from the forces of evil? And then what are the angels practically doing about it on their end? And then third, the situation with the so-called alternative media. And what is it really doing, given the fact that some, not all, of the most famous faces and names in this alternative field are nothing else but a subdivision of the centrally orchestrated mass media? And then I'll touch the concept of the critical mass in terms of awakening of the humanity, the idea that even if a small number of us reach enlightenment, that will pull the rest of humanity upwards. Is there any practical use of this and a few other modern New Age concepts? And then the last topic will be the class of people called preppers. So a viewer of my channel sent me the following question. Unfortunately, I have not read any of the works of the given author, so I can't tell you my opinion about it. But just the very formulation of your question, I think, can provide very valuable information of that how the forces of evil practically poison our belief system. And once our heads are poisoned, then we spoil the rest of our lives ourselves. About Islam, I can give you very good information, first-hand experience, because many years ago when I was young, I lived 2 years in Dubai, a very Muslim country, and I can assure you that those Muslims are the most simple and peaceful and non-abusive folks you can imagine. While on the other hand, at the moment I live in the heart of Europe, exactly in the middle of all this theater that is going on, foreigners are raping women and committing other serious violent crimes, and the police is ordered to look the other way when this happens. So it is confusing when you say Islam, which Islam, the traditional Islam religion? If you think that raping and killing is encouraged by it, you're seriously wrong. Because their punishments for these things are much more strict than any other country, and they do implement them. So people really think twice before committing such acts over there. Now, when these new ideas that now we see the crime scenes in Europe, about which are also called Islam, started being introduced in the Middle East, by the way, by foreign entities, the local people, they were really begging the mass media, they were repeatedly sending messages, please don't call this Islam, we don't want to have anything to do with these things. Of course, people here in the West never even heard those pleads, and the mass media continued barking about this new Islam, mixing it with the old Islam. Meanwhile, the foreign entities who created the full thing continued pumping big money into it and educating often illiterate local people now in the Islamic areas, indoctrinating them into the new Islam. And now it is becoming widespread. Even some normal Muslims, so to say, start partially believing in this new idea, or at least some elements of it, again, because they are offered substantial financial perks for believing in them. So I have no clue if this lady really sees angels, but if she does see them in the mosques, I wouldn't be surprised at the slightest, because there are still many millions of old type Muslims who are actually very peaceful and pure people. They respect their wives, all women, and cultivate qualities which are considered godly by all religions, not just Islam. So twisting the very meaning of the religions for political manipulation has been going on for a very long time. Even a brand new, in a sense, religion like New Age or something like a religion, even that is already heavily infiltrated, although it's barely decades old. So can we imagine how much the religions have been twisted, the religions that have been around for hundreds of years? But the question is, when we know that this is going on, do we buy into it? For example, you are having a doubt that she might be promoting globalism, which I understand to mean the forces of evil, which under the banner of a brotherhood and loving each other are just promoting crime and enslavement of humanity. Well, they obviously have no brotherhood and loving each other in their minds at all in their agenda. This is pretty obvious. But have you considered that this lady might be actually referring to the real meaning of brotherhood and love and compassion and acceptance? And here we finally reach the core of the problem, which is that because of educational indoctrination, people are in the process of forgetting the real meaning of love and compassion. Just because those very same terms have been used by the mass media to signify projects of social engineering promoting crime, insanity, and zombification. Loving and accepting the spiritual spark, the soul, of a person who happens to be a criminal, a racist, anything horrible you can imagine, doesn't mean encouraging them and looking the other side when they do crime. The way to show a compassion and love to people who have committed serious violent crimes is spending your taxpayer money to provide good prison conditions for them, proper therapies. For example, meditation therapies have proven to be very successful in such cases. For example, if by chance you happen to sit and talk to such a person, you should not be treated with hatred. You should not tell him, "I want to punch your ugly mug." Because that will make him more bitter. He may think of revenge and committing more crimes. Instead, maybe you should tell him, "Brother, what's wrong with you? These people, you have come from abroad, these people have been feeding you. They have been giving you house and money for free. I have the feeling that according to your God, Allah, these people should be respected and loved. Don't you think like this?" And maybe during his long, lonely hours in prison, he may remember your words. Maybe they will make him change. Or even if he forgets them, still you have done your part. You have not dirtied your own consciousness with the feeling of hatred. How to love and accept a criminal? It doesn't mean inviting him home and learning from him. It means that while you feel compassion for him all the time, you get sure he is humanely prosecuted and punished so that the contagion doesn't spread in the society further. And also by learning from this situation, this is very important because the road to hell is paved with good intention. And this person, he got poisoned by some sort of hatred at some point, and then he became vulnerable to being manipulated and indoctrinated into hating, for example, foreigners or something like that. He got convinced that those people deserve to be harmed for whatever reason he believes. You should consider all this very carefully and see how dangerous it is to go on the road of hatred. If you choose to hate the criminal as a person instead of only consider his actions evil, and then if the circumstances somehow nourish this hatred and make it grow in you, which is very easy nowadays due to the environment we live in, then you run the risk that you will find yourself one day convinced to go to a foreign country and commit crimes to innocent people over there. me personally, it seems that most people nowadays don't think so much about these definitions. They just follow the herd. Some of them believe in really unbelievable stuff, like they refuse to even look at the information about these crimes, even when the crimes are committed in front of their eyes, because this, according to them, is tolerance towards Islam. My God, how can it be favorable towards Islam if Islam is the religion which condemns them most, especially raping, violence? Islam has the strictest laws against it. Many people in Europe here avoid even the very topic of these skyrocketing crimes of rape and violence, and they think they make this in the name of brotherhood and loving each other. Putting an equation mark between terrible violence and, on the other hand, love and brotherhood doesn't seem to bother these people. Well, good luck to them. But the majority of people react in a different way. Unfortunately, majority of people react with hatred, combined with increasing their feeling of being helpless in comparison to the almighty politicians who rule against the will of the people. And as long as the people believe that they are helpless, they surely will be, because they will take no action. And then, as far as how angels can practically help us, again, the same problem, the ignorance of the people, the very definition of what angels are and what they do here has been so much distorted and twisted that even when real angels come in human form or any other form, also in astral form, people cannot recognize them and benefit from their presence. Or other nonsense are going on, like, for example, not doing what you should be doing when you got born here as a human and waiting the angels to do it for you. And our ignorance can reach such unbelievable heights to the point that angels can be standing right in front of us and people will deny their existence simply because they don't believe in angels. For example, I personally know two men, very highly educated people, very refined, with a couple of university degrees. So they were traveling with a car in Scotland and they saw fairies walking in the forest. And everybody saw them as clear as daylight. So they are very honest people, so they frankly tell whatever they saw, but they stand behind their beliefs. And they say, we are telling you what we saw, but also we tell you that we don't believe in these things. Now, what separates men from angels? I think the best example I can think of is Bruno Gröning. I believe that he was an angel who came in human form specifically to help us because of the miracles he performed from his balcony in his house, surrounded by thousands of people, many of them seriously sick, some of them in wheelchairs, others brought by relatives on stretchers. He would just talk to them and they would rise from their sickness and their wheelchairs and stretchers right there on the spot. So this went on for some time after the war. Many people got cured. Some are alive even till now to tell the stories, and plenty of eyewitnesses are alive as well. So how did the personal life of Bruno develop? He started being bothered by legal cases because he's healing people without having medical education. So he was banned from healing, and after they continued bothering him, he simply told people, I understand, this is normal, this world is like this, if you come to do good, this is how they treat you. And he died shortly after that without even living to old age. So this is what separates us from the angels. Our ignorance, again, the very same thing. Nowadays, journalists testify how in those old times they were specifically paid to slander and write lies about Bruno. Probably some people bought them, or I don't know how exactly, but they allowed their corrupt government to interrupt his angelic mission. But this is only from the perspective of how the world in general treated him. The more important is that each of us lives in our own reality. And as Bruno said, those who were qualified to receive his angelic help, they got cured. He cured so many people because personally they were mature enough to meet and appreciate an angel. In the description I will place a link to a documentary about Bruno Gröning. Just I wanted to mention one last point in your question about all cultures melting into one by promoting love and acceptance. Now, this is very general, but if somebody is preaching to you that all cultures must merge in one, and that's why for this purpose the local traditions should be eradicated, and all this is in the name of loving each other and brotherhood, I wouldn't buy this as angelic philosophy. Urging people to abandon their local traditions in the name of having only one culture so that we can love each other is just one of the countless ideological traps of the evil forces. It's much better to cherish the legends and traditions of your own land rather than accepting this one world, all-loving culture, because somewhere with very fine print it's written the clarification that this all-loving actually means zombie servant of the devil. So, as we saw, the same words can mean completely different things to different people. And the question, will angels come to save humanity from evil, will have for some people the answer no, and for some yes. For the majority of people, the answer will be no, because the way they will imagine it is that some flying fairy creature will all of a sudden come with thunder from the skies and kill maybe the evil political leaders or the owners of the corrupt big money organizations, things like that. No, such scenario is not gonna develop because we have caused being blood-sucked alive like this with our ignorance. Not only in astral sense, these corrupt leaders represent all the feelings that we have allowed in us, like self-hatred, hating others, envy, anger and so on, but also in a very practical sense, we elect those corrupted leaders ourselves, or we are too lazy to take any action when they are placed in such position by the means of fraudulent elections, for example. We find it much more meaningful to watch basketball. But yet there is another type of people, the people who understand angels and know how to interact with them, and for them the answer, will they come and save us, will be definitely yes. If you know how to interact with your guardian angels, they will be surely helping you in these extremely difficult times, which will be getting way more difficult maybe in the very near future. The guardian angels of people who do not believe in angels, or of the people who don't know how to understand when there is divine intervention, will not abandon them as well. It is just the ignorant people will not be able to recognize it when something like that happens. And historically, in the legends, we hear that in faraway times, entire nations were in regular communication with celestial beings, and those helped them very actively. The legends are not a precise historic account, but a much more reliable one than the textbooks of our schools. So most likely the accounts where really angels come and, for example, help the nations that they protect in a practical way during battles or other very critical moments. And most likely that's how it was in reality.